in some of the towns throughout the state, and just advising MMA members of this and hoping to, through efforts of that organization, to turn that around somewhat. He did have recommendations, some of which coincided with our council stated goals about improving communications with our legislative representatives. Two of his specific recommendations were to try breakfast meetings with those representatives, or having them stop by Friday afternoon after, if they're heading home after a session, and just drop a quick report in the town hall. I don't know if we want to follow up on either of those suggestions, but I do know that we were concerned about communication with the two representative and senator. Another thing he mentioned that could become relevant if anybody in the school system wanted to take up on it is that MMA has a 22-minute video about involvement in local government. And as I said, this might be appropriate for a school class, or it might be something that our cable channel would like to show. We can investigate that. He gave a report on the state of the Maine Municipal Association, saying they plan to update their data bank to be able to provide more complete town profiles to the legislature, similar, I'm expecting, to what James just presented from COG. And they hope to establish a first district congressional municipal advisory council, which would be modeled after the governor's advisory council. They have had conversations with Joe Brennan about this, and he was very supportive of doing that. So perhaps, hopefully, after the election, this will come about. And the purpose of this council would be to have quarterly meetings with our congressional representatives, again, to have improved communications. The other part of my visit to Augusta was to attend a committee meeting of the MMA Legislative Policy Committee. And I'll follow up on something Jane said. To warm you up for Jane's survey for COG, if you haven't filled out the MMA Legislative Policy Survey, if you would get that one done first to warm you up for Jane's, it would be terrific. They've had a lot of them returned, but if you haven't turned it in yet, they'd need it as soon as possible. So far, their survey results indicate that solid waste and property taxes are the areas of highest concern to town officials. They did have a discussion about the governor's suggestion to have the county commissioners be responsible for regional solid waste management, and we were assured that that discussion would be continued in further committee meetings. Mm-hmm. And I'll brag a little about our town manager. He was quoted by the MMA Legislative Policy Committee in a report he had done when he was working on his degree at USM, I believe, stating that although municipal officials don't consider themselves effective lobbyists, the legislators perceive municipal officials to be very effective, and we are encouraged to step up our role in that aspect. So if you get phone calls or you have suggestions to pass on, they'd like to have that.
Very good. Thank you for your report. You make an excellent representative to the MMA of our council. By the way, you are all now attending a historic session. It's the first session where the reports and correspondence may actually last longer than the agenda items. And I'm still going to press on with this section, ladies and gentlemen, because I do like historic meetings. Are there other reports and correspondence? Yes, Councilor Jordan.
We have to go down the line. I didn't know Nancy might have something, but I don't want to get into the cheerleading part of it, but I'd like to commend Public Works Department for tearing down the jungle along Scott Dyer Road and by the playgrounds at the middle school, which used to be the high school in my day, and the old athletic field. But now somebody else has moved in and dug it all up and taken the topsoil off. So is there another jungle coming back, or is it supposed to be a professional playground area?
This weekend, the middle school parents, or a group led by the middle school parents, are constructing a playground on that site with money that's raised from the community. I believe it's 250 volunteers. They're looking for 150.
Well, they have 150 show up. I'm sure they'll be work this day.
If you'd like to help out, Councilor Jordan, I'm sure they'd more than welcome you. Anyone else?
You want one of my one-liners?
Breaking that microphone.
Councilor Masterson.
You're forcing me to speak.
Sure.
I do have four items coming up, so I didn't really want to say anything at the outset, but you're forcing me. As you all know, I have co-chaired along with Bill Diamond of Wyndham for the past year a COG group called the Property Tax Reform Task Force. And we really have been working very hard developing a lot of data concerning the costs to citizens of the property tax and some various alternatives to reform it, including school subsidy reform that Councilor Amaral knows about, and various incentives on the local level to provide property tax relief. I will be able to report more in a few weeks, but we are forming a coalition and hoping to involve York County. The purpose of the coalition would be to formulate goals that the region would go after in the legislature. Now the COG has the ability to advocate and to lobby in the legislature and elsewhere. This coalition will be actively engaged in that and making recommendations in the next few weeks and months. So I will keep you abreast of more specifics as they develop. Coalition has not been formed as yet.
Do you want to have a survey first of all?
We promise not, no survey.
I'm going to continue on with three brief reports and correspondence that I consider to be important. Occasionally, a town councilor receives an award that we really find worthy of note and with a great deal of pride. And I'd like to just point out again, to those of you who don't know, that a new $3.5 million University of Southern Maine classroom building on Bedford Street will house the School of Nursing, the Department of Social Welfare, a computer center, and general classrooms. It will be named for late Portland banker Robert R. Masterton and his wife, Councilor Nancy Masterton. Nancy will also become chair of the university's Community Leadership Institute. And for those of you who aren't familiar, each year the Institute sponsors an 11-week program for community leaders to increase their knowledge of economic, political, legal, and social structures in Southern Maine. So we're extremely proud of both of these things for you, Nancy, and congratulate you sincerely. I would also like to note that I received in my packet minutes of the Scarborough Town Council meeting, which the pertinent part to us as citizens of Cape Elizabeth came in a motion from Councilor Harmon, seconded by Councilor Lorfano, who moved to vote support to the town of Cape Elizabeth in their attempt to obtain legislative action to establish the Spurwink River to be the natural boundary for the two towns. And we wanted to thank publicly the Scarborough Town Council for their supporting us on this issue, and assure them that after the November elections are completed, we'll be talking to our state rep and our state senator regarding getting the legislation moving forward so that once and for all we have the definitive town line established and people know where to pay taxes and what town they live in. And lastly, from my end, I just wanted to point out those of you who have followed us to Channel 38, we thank you. You found us in our new home. Others may still be looking at this point across the dial, but I also wanted to mention in talking and working with the people at Channel 38, our public access, they're very enthusiastic. Volunteers are coming forward, really good people working there, and lining up with our town council goals. They'll be starting a new program, which they're going to try to do monthly, which is a live call-in program, where key members of certain town committees and boards will be sitting here with a moderator to discuss issues that are, again, in front of the board and give the opportunity for a citizen call-in type program. We're going to be attempting to do that on a monthly basis. The first program, the town manager and myself have been invited to have the inaugural show, so things will probably go uphill from there, who knows, but it should be an interesting night. It's going to be next Monday at 7:30, and then subsequently we hope that you'll look for that show and participate in the upcoming months ahead as we have representatives of the planning board, et cetera, coming forward. So I think it's exciting to see us branching into some new two-way communications with the citizens. That's what this is all about, this public access. And I want to again compliment the enthusiasm and the real hard work and volunteerism that goes behind those cameras. So congratulations to all of you. Are there any other reports and correspondence? We are now well into record-breaking time, so yes.
Very briefly. Last May, the town council, when they approved the budget, approved for the refuse disposal area to be open for 4 Sundays in the fall for the purpose of disposing of brush and demolition material, sort of fall cleanup. The first week that it will be open will be on Sunday, October 23rd. It will continue for the next 3 Sundays. The hours will be 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. And we will accept all material with the exception of what usually goes into the transfer station. Unfortunately, we do not have capacity at the transfer station to handle what would come in on Sunday. So therefore, we're not able to handle that. But anyone who has leaves that they'd like to dispose of, demolition material, or newspapers that they'd like to recycle, the refuse disposal area will be open on 4 Sundays, beginning October 23rd, from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. So that was as a result of town council action last May. Secondly, Sawyer Road, the first coat of paving is due to go on next Tuesday. These microphones were due to go in 2 months ago, went in this week. I mention that because even though we've been told it'll be next Tuesday, I'm not holding my breath. But for those of you that travel Sawyer Road, you should see a major improvement there next week.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. If there's no further reports and correspondence, if you like that part, wait till you see when we actually get to the agenda items. These are even more interesting. First one we are going to open with is a public hearing regarding approving a malt, Venus, and spiritus license for the Inn by the Sea. So we now are opening up that portion of the evening to a public hearing. If there's anyone that would like to come forward and speak on this item from the public, now would be the appropriate time. Seeing none, I would close the public hearing section and take up item 42, which is for the town council to consider approving a malt, Venus, and spiritus license for the Inn by the Sea and take any necessary action. Is there any discussion by the council or questioning?
I move that we grant it.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to grant the license as we have it here in front of us. Applicants, Great Bay Hotels, Inc., business Inn by the Sea. Any further discussion? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of approving the license? Any opposed? Passes unanimously. The next section we have is a public hearing regarding the Town Ways Ordinance, and this is to consider proposed amendments to the Town Ways Ordinance. And I would like to turn it over to the Chairman of the Ordinance Committee, Councilor Masterton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not going to read this ordinance because it is several pages long, and I think that you would find it quite boring. But let me just quickly review what these amendments do cover. Section 17-1-1 of the ordinances defines public road and adequate site distance. Section 17-2 requires entrance permits on all public roads issued by the Public Works Director. Section 17-2-3 does away with the presently required raised separations between multiple drives. These may, however, be required by the Planning Board if appropriate in a subdivision. Section 17-3 has standards for excavation of streets and utility installation. Section 17-5, regulation of heavy loads and penalties. And there are other minor changes, just housekeeping matters in this proposed revised ordinance.
Thank you very much for your report. I would like to see if anyone, at this time, if anyone from the general public wishes to speak on the Town Ways Ordinance, the proposed amendments to this Town Ways Ordinance. We discussed it at the last town council meeting, had some, a few, I think, minor changes that went into it, and now is the appropriate time for the members of the public to come forward. Seeing none, I'd close the public hearing portion of this meeting and take up item 43 to consider the proposed amendments to Town Ways Ordinance and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I move that it is ordered to adopt the changes in the town ways ordinance as contained in the draft dated October 5th, 1988.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to accept the proposed amendments as we have them before us in our packet. Are there any further, is there any further discussion or any further questions regarding these?
Yes, sir.
Councilor Jordan.
As a member of the ordinance committee and a minority member of that committee, I am opposed to a section of this ordinance. I agree with what they're intending to do, but I'll explain it. And this is reconstruction and repaving of roads. And once that road is reconstructed or repaved, you cannot open it unless it's an emergency for 5 years. So I say, and I feel very strongly, that this is a sense of confiscating somebody's land for 5 years. Because if they wanted to build a house or they wanted to do something, they had to go the other side of the street to get the water. They're not allowed to do it because that, I don't believe you can constitute an emergency. Now, unless they get their house up and they need to make a repair, that's a little different. So I'm opposed to this. I'm not opposed to the rest of this ordinance. I'm opposed to this section 17.3-10. And for that one reason, I think 5 years is too long. And 3 years, I think probably I could accept, but I spoke at the meeting that I was opposed to the 5 years. And also on 17-5-1, on heavy loads, I just want to get cleared up, and maybe the manager of the Public Works director could do that for me. When they speak of posting the roads and registered gross vehicle weight limits on any town public roads, do you look at that as a axle weight, or do you look at it, as I read it, as a gross vehicle weight? You can take the same vehicle and add another axle, and you wouldn't do as much damage to the road and still have the same amount of weight on it. And I think that should be looked at a little bit before it's accepted. This is something that just come to me today when I got thinking about tonight's meeting. I don't know how either one of them want to look at it, but I think it should be looked at.
Mike?
It would be, under this proposal, it would be based on registered gross vehicle weight. Before any of these took effect, the town council, under this provision, would in fact review them and determine whether or not those weights are appropriate. I'm not sure if that answered your question.
Means I get another whack at it.
That's right.
Okay.
What about the, I see that the Public Works Director is here. Chairman, perhaps you'd like to answer.
Yes.
Bills.
Would you like to come forward and enlighten us further?
Well, I'd like to respond to Councilor Jordan's comment on Section 17.3-10, and I guess I feel pretty strongly about the five-year moratorium. It's something that the DOT, Department of Transportation, requires after they do a major reconstruction or repaving. The town of Scarborough recently passed this requirement, and it really, it's really a shame. Once we repave a road or reconstruct it, we like to get between 10 and 15 years out of them. And it's really discouraging when you repave a road and 2 years down the road somebody's digging into it. I do understand his concerns, and we discussed it at the meeting, that there's two sides to the story, but as a public works director, I have to support my roads, so. I feel very strongly about it.
And, could waivers be granted if there were exceptional circumstances that arose, like Councilor Jordan just said, that there may be times when you absolutely have to get it across the road, I don't know, to hook into a utility or whatever the situation?
As a general rule, hooking in a water service does not constitute an emergency access into the street, so that would be prohibited. The only time it could be dug up if it was a plugged sewer or breaking the water main or a leak in the gas main or such like that.
Yes, Councilor Greenland.
Can somebody go about requesting a waiver of this? What's the procedure if they want to request a waiver? Is there a process?
I don't believe there's a provision in this. Something could be instituted like that. But, as it's written here right now, there is no provision for it.
Well, in your years of experience, then, with this, what type do these emergencies arise? I mean, not emergencies, but do the non-emergencies arise? Is it likely?
We've had a case down on Route 77 in the vicinity of State Avenue, where there was a proposed subdivision for the city of South Portland that was going to be tying into our sewer system, and that road was rebuilt in 1983, and they came to us in, I believe, 86. And they wanted to open the street up, and we did prohibit them. But that was because it was done by the Department of Transportation, and it was their requirement, not ours. But we did prohibit them from digging the street.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Cogshaw?
This particular part of the ordinance only deals with the town roads. There is already a requirement on state roads.
That's correct.
Not true?
That's correct.
That prohibits opening them up before a five-year period. And those are a lot of streets and roads already in Cape Elizabeth. So this sort of is treating everyone more or less fairly, as well as not wasting the money that we spend on resurfacing or reconstructing roads and then having to repave them again. And Scarborough is not the only town that has this five-year requirement. Wasn't it Westbrook?
Westbrook, South Portland.
Westbrook and South Portland do as well.
They're all starting to move in this direction. It's basically an offshoot of development. A lot of your roads are repaved, and now that house lots have been popping up, it's become a problem.
Is there any further discussion on 17310? This is what we're talking about. Yes.
I'd like to ask a question to the manager or the public works director. We'll say a developer built a development, and he put in the water main, paved the road. When would the 5 years start? After he paved the road or after town accepted it?
The provision in the ordinance is that this does not take effect unless we have sent notice by registered mail to all the property owners who might be affected. Unless we had actually sent a notice to someone, it would not be effective. The reason I mention that is the date that notice was sent out would be the date that the 5 years would start. And after we sent that notice, then they still have 60 days in which to dig up the road and do whatever they want, essentially whatever they want. But that would be when the 5 years would begin, from the time that we send out the notice saying they had 60 days to dig wherever they pleased.
So if the developer build a road, pave it, and maybe a year went by or so, and they then asked the town to accept it. After the town accepted it, then you would send them out a notice, and they'd have 15 days to dig up that road if they wanted to make another connection or something. Is that what you're saying?
It's 60 days, but this is contemplated on public roads.
Well,
if it had not been a public road, we would not have sent the notice.
Once the town accepts it, it becomes a public road, doesn't it?
That's right.
So after the town accepts it, the developer has paved the road and brought it up to standards for the town to accept. Mm. It may be a year later or so the town accepts it. The 5 years go on then. Is that what you're saying?
I would assume so, because it doesn't belong to the town until it's
so
officially accepted.
They have so many days they could dig in it, even though it's a A1 road, till you get that notice out.
That's right.
Councilor Massey.
We have to send out the notice, as this says, the section is void.
Councilor Massey.
Bob, the sewer pipes and the water pipes go along the shoulder of the road, don't they?
Not always.
Let's take
in some
Sawyer
cases,
Road. There are no sewer pipes there.
That's correct.
Water pipes?
Yes.
Are the side of the road or under the road?
It varies. On Sawyer Road, in some portions, it's on the edge of the road. But it can be in the middle and it can be on the edge. It depends on the road.
So it is possible to tie into a water pipe in certain places without having to excavate in the road.
That's correct.
Road.
Yeah.
Does that make you feel better?
Oh, no, I knew that. I knew you put one side to the other. I guess I kind of caught it. This gone around my mind for quite a few days, so I studied it pretty well.
Any further discussion on 17.3.10 regarding possible amendments or other feelings on the issue? Or if not, is there any other... Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any other discussion in general on the town ways ordinance? They've been seconded, is that correct? I mean, it's been moved and seconded. Okay.
Yes.
So if there's no further discussion, I will then call for a vote. All those in favor of adopting the amendments as we have them in the packet, signify by raising your hand. All right, all those opposed? So they passed 6-1. Councilor Jordan opposed. We have another public hearing on considering proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance. And we have them in our packet, and at this point I'd like to ask any citizens that would like to come forward to speak on these proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance to please do so at this time. If no one's coming forward, I will close the public hearing portion and take up item 44, which is to consider the proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance. And Councilor Masterton, I ask for your report.
These changes apply to section 19-4-7 of the zoning ordinance, jurisdiction of Board of Zoning Appeals. And we're not changing the jurisdiction, really. There are two sections on that. One is to determine whether the decision of the building inspector is in conformity with the provisions of this ordinance, and the other is to grant variances. We have changed the language with regard to the variances owing to conditions peculiar to any property and not the result of the actions of the applicant. Literal enforcement of the ordinance would result in unnecessary and. We have struck that, result in unnecessary and added cause undue hardship, and added as defined by 30 MRSA section 4963, supplement 1987. So the word cause is defined by the statutes. Now, I do want to read what a major addition to this section 2. No right shall accrue to the recipient of any variance unless the recipient records a certificate of variance in conformity with 30 MRSA section 4963, supplement 1987, in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds within 30 days of final approval of the variance. Notwithstanding the recording of a certificate of variance, the recipient's legal rights set forth in a variance shall expire if the construction or alteration involved is not substantially completed within 1 year from the date on which the variance was granted. This variance expiration provision shall be effective for all variances approved after January 1, 1989. I thought I'd better read that because if you come before the Board of Zoning Appeals for a variance and you get it, you've got to know that you've got to, and I'm sure you'll be informed when you receive your variance, that you must record a certificate of that variance at the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds, and that your rights to do the construction under which the variance was granted, you have 1 year to do it after the variance has been granted. So that's a significant change.
Thank you very much, Councilor Masterton. So I'd like to now open the discussion up to my fellow councilors on item number 44. Councilor Cogshill.
I'd like to move that it be ordered to adopt the changes in section 19.4.7 of the zoning ordinance as contained in the draft labeled item number 44.
Second.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt them as we have them in front
of the planning board, and the Ordinance Committee and now the council. Councilor Coggeshall was chairman of the Zoning Board of Appeals at the time that it was reviewed. I guess she helped originate it. Do you have anything further to
No, I can just say that the initial requirement of filing the variance, certificate of variance with the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds is required by the state. Yep. And since it has been mandated, it is best that it also be written in our ordinances so that it would be clear to any citizen who came before the board. Also, a variance is granted upon a hardship. There are four different conditions they have to meet. And if that hardship exists and the variance is granted, it is not unreasonable to expect that it be completed, substantially completed within a year of that variance. There have been situations where variances have been granted and even within 5 years they had not been even started. A lot of the legislation now has the sunset dates or an expiration date, and it is perfectly in keeping with reasonable government, I think. It also was reviewed, and the actual wording was constructed by the town attorney.
Thank you, Councilor. Excuse me. Any further discussion on item 44? Before I either choke or we go on, one of the two. With all the bright lights, this is not a good place to get a tickle, I can assure you. So let's go on. I'd like to call for a vote on this. All those in favor of item 44? Any opposed? It passes unanimously. We have another public hearing tonight. We have many opportunities for the public to come to speak. You see how what a democratic council this is? This public hearing is on a proposed amendment to the Disturbing the Peace Ordinance, which is an amendment to the Miscellaneous Offenses Ordinance, and I'd like to ask Councilor Masterton again, our chairman of the Ordinance Committee, to give a brief report on this.
Well, actually what we have done here, this comes under the, well, we're calling it the Noise Ordinance, but it comes under Section 12-1-1, of the Cape Ordinances, and it's called Disturbing the Peace. And there are two, we have deleted some archaic language, old-fashioned language about shouting, sounding horns, drums, or indecent songs or words, any other unruly or boisterous manner disturbing the peace, quiet, and good order of the town. We have deleted all that archaic language and substituted for that. Within the town of Cape Elizabeth, no person shall make, continue, or cause to be made any loud, profane, boisterous, unnecessary, or unusual noises which shall either annoy, disturb, injure, or endanger the comfort, repose, health, peace, or safety of others. This shall not apply to agricultural activities, to school-sponsored events, to firework shows approved by the fire chief, or to concerts approved by the town council. Now, the second addition to Section 12-1-1 really was inspired by a citizen of Cape Elizabeth who wrote us a letter complaining about some construction that was going on across the street from her, and she was disturbed at some early hour in the morning, 5:30 or 6 a.m., when workers were banging around and disturbing her. So we have added the following. B, no person shall perform or carry on or cause to be performed or carried on any construction or excavation work during the hours between 10 p.m. and 7 a.m. that produces noise of a sufficient volume to disturb the sleep or repose of occupants of neighboring properties. This paragraph shall not apply in the event of an emergency in which a sewer, conduit, or utility in or under any street breaks, bursts, or otherwise in such condition as to immediately endanger the property, life, health, or safety of any individual. It shall also not apply to repairs necessitated by storm events, earthquakes, and other acts, quote, acts of God, close quote.
Thank you, Councilor Masterton. Would anyone in the public care to come forward to speak on our proposed amendments to the miscellaneous offenses ordinances regarding disturbing the peace? And as you know, the town council meetings do not apply either to this, by the way, because they often do become boisterous and noisy. Seeing no one coming forward, I would close the public hearing section and take up item 45, which is to consider the proposed amendments to miscellaneous offenses ordinances regarding disturbing of the peace.
Do you want to make a motion?
Councilor Greenlaw.
I defer to Councilor Jordan.
Oh, I'll defer to the lady.
I move that it be ordered to adopt the changes in the miscellaneous offenses ordinance relating to disturbing the peace as contained in the draft dated September 8, 1988.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt the ordinances that the amendments that we have in front of us, item 45. All those in favor? Any opposed? Passes unanimously, 7-0. Our last public hearing of the evening, but not the end. We still have other items to take up. But our last public hearing regards subdivision ordinances, considering proposed amendments to the subdivision ordinance. And once again, Councilor Masterton, chairman of our ordinance committee, will have a brief report for us. Obviously getting paid overtime this week.
I just, speaking of brevity, it is golden. I spent the afternoon in Augusta at the Board of Environmental Protection listening to comments on their noise regulations, and they are pages and pages and full of DBAs and LNBs, and I can just say that our own newly passed noise ordinance is mercifully brief and concise. I love it. Okay, this last revision is under General Standards of Subdivision Design, and it's section 16-3-1, subsections O and Q of the subdivision ordinance. The O and Q do two things. O requires the developer to preserve, whenever practical, to preserve natural features such as watercourses or bodies, existing trees of 10 inches or more in diameter, base height, marshes, swamps, and other areas identified in the official wetlands map, open space, scenic points, historic spots, and unusual or striking topographic features, which, if preserved, would add to the attractiveness of the subdivision. This paragraph, we're not changing that, but I just wanted you to know that this paragraph goes on to say that the planning board may require the subdivider to dedicate such features to joint ownership and management by the owners of individual lots within the subdivision or the owners of condominium units. However, in lieu of dedication to the homeowners, the planning board may accept dedication to the town itself or an appropriate, and the language reads now, third-party group or organization such as the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Now, what we have done with this paragraph is two very simple things. We have added the words nonprofit before third-party group. So we're talking about a nonprofit third-party group. And we have deleted such as the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. We certainly, we don't want to be discriminatory. There may be other nonprofit groups than the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Certainly they would be included as a nonprofit third-party group. But we don't want to exclude any other groups that might come along and be appropriate and qualified to receive the dedication. Now, Section Q goes on to say that the planning board shall require the subdivider to provide an area suitable for recreation or open space purposes up to 10% of the subdivision's total land area, or pay a fee to the town in accordance with the fee schedule established by the town council for recreation and open space land acquisition purposes, primarily for the use of owners of lots within the subdivision, in order to address a recreational or open space deficiency to be created by the proposed subdivision. And it goes on to talk about what the fee will be based upon, in other words, the current assessed value of the land. All we have done to this paragraph is to add at the very beginning of it, in addition to the requirements set forth in section 16-3-1O, which is the one dealing with preserving natural features, which shall be required by the planning board. So we have two considerations here, the natural features and the 10% of the total for recreation or open space, or the fee. That, in a nutshell, Mr. Chairman. I apologize, when we posted these to public hearing, I did try to just summarize them, but I think when we're discussing them in public hearing, the citizens should be aware specifically of what we are dealing with.
And so should the council, for that matter.
Well, the council has them before them to
right.
read.
But thank you for that very further in-depth discussion of this item this evening. Is there anyone in the public that would like to come forward to speak on these small but important revisions to the subdivision ordinance? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing portion and open item number 46, which is to consider the proposed amendments to the subdivision ordinance, up now to the town council.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Jordan.
I'll move the order to adopt the change in the subdivision ordinance as contained in the draft labeled on item 46.
Seconded.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt the amendments as proposed on item 46 here. Is there any further discussion? Councilor Cramer.
I'm just a little confused about the language here and the nature of this 10%. Now, it says up to 10%. Does this give the discretionary right to the planning board, for example, in a particular case to determine that 5% of a particular subdivision would be adequate? I thought that 10% was a bit of a goal standard at some point. Have we changed that at all?
This isn't proposed to be changed. It does provide for up to 10%. It could be 5%. It's whatever area they feel is suitable for recreation or open space, and they could go as high as 10% in order to find that they have a suitable area.
And that would be the same interpretation then for the fee schedule. The fee schedule would be somewhere between 0% and 10% then?
No.
No.
The fee should be based on the current assessed value of the land as listed in the town assessor's record.
10%?
Well, whatever the planning board decides.
Well, that was my question. Can they decide, again, somewhere between 0 and 10%, or is that 10% a fixed fee?
No, it doesn't say that.
Up to.
There was a fee schedule that's been adopted by the town council. I don't have it with me tonight, I don't believe, but I don't believe it's flexible.
Mm-hmm. So it would be a set fee then, based on the size of the land area?
Yes.
The fee would be a substitute for setting aside the land.
Right, I understand that.
Wasn't it based on the number of lots?
Yes.
I mean, the number of
There were several
dwelling
different
units. It wasn't the size of
the neighborhood. I can't remember what it is either. Mm-hmm. But we have done that.
Okay. Just wanted to clarify that. Thank
yes.
you.
Michael McGovern.
I just did want to relate to the town council. I had a meeting last week with the chairman of the planning board, the chairman of the conservation commission, and the president of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust regarding these ordinance amendments. They came to the office late last week. They have no problem with you adopting any of these ordinance provisions. However, they did want me to let you know that the planning board is looking at some other perceived deficiencies in the subdivision amendments, subdivision regulations, some that are minor in language. They also do us some concern even within these sections that you're amending to ensure that conservation is not lost in the process, land set aside for conservation purposes as well as recreation purposes. And so you probably will have some proposed amendments to the subdivision regulations coming to you again, I would guess, probably in two to four months.
Councilor Massey.
Well, as far as that conservation is concerned, I look at subparagraph O as being, addressing conservation, because we are talking about preserving natural features there. I think that really spells out any kind of conservation that you would want to indulge in.
Any other further comments on item 46? If there are none, then I would like to ask for a vote on the motion before us. All those in favor of item 46? Any opposed? None. It passes 7-0. Passes unanimously. Moving on to item 47, what we have before us here is considering a report from the Planning Board regarding a request from I. Allen Balfour to rezone from RP District to RA District, land in the vicinity of Pine Ridge Road, and take any necessary action. The Council has before them in their packets tonight this request for a zone change. We also have the recommendations and the finding of facts of the Planning Board at a recent meeting. And thirdly, we have the inventory of wetlands on the Balfour property as conducted by John C. Malley. So I would now, at this time, like to open this up to discussion. First of all, as we do before every agenda item, I would ask if there's any public comment on this issue. Seeing none, I would then ask my fellow councilors if they would like to comment or what they wish to do with item 47.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Councilor Amaro.
I would move that we schedule a public hearing on Monday, November 14th at 7:30 at the Town Hall on this matter.
And I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded to move this to a public hearing on November 14th, which is our regularly scheduled November meeting at 7:30. Any further discussion tonight on this? Councilor Jordan?
Don't know whether I should just bring out my points tonight or wait until the public hearing. But can anybody tell me, was the owner notified when they put this in the RP zone? Does anybody know that?
I think this was rezoned at the same time the Plummer lot that you discussed last month was rezoned. I think it was a legal ad placed in the newspaper. You know, whether or not a specific notice was sent to this property owner, I don't believe that one was.
Is there any way we could find out before the public hearing? Oh, you're pretty sure that's all it was?
Yeah, there was.
Okay,
yeah,
that's okay.
No notices were sent to all the property owners whose zones were being changed all around town going to RP.
I read John Malley's report, and I respect Mr. Malley tremendously, and I know him real well. I understood the time of year that they done it, that they had him do it in March. Ice in the area and things like that. I wouldn't think that was a very good year, unless a very good time of year to survey land, unless you wanted to make sure it was wetlands when you get done. That would be my offhand remark on it, because that's a good time of year. As he mentioned in it, there was ice there and streams and what have you. And another thing I'd like to know before the public hearing, if it's all possible, with the construction around Broad Cove and the area at the time, I'd like to know if any of the materials that was removed when they constructed other parts of it and put in that neighborhood to cause this. Don't take too many years to dam up an area a little bit, just a few inches, and make it into wetlands over the years, that type of grasses and what have you, and that all the bushes and what have you will grow up, and you know, it takes about 3 years or so, and you'll start to see them come up out of the ground. So I would like to know if that had anything to do with this area. If you'd pass that on to someone, I was going to call John Malley myself and get his opinion on it. Okay.
Yes,
I think I should mention it. Mr. Malley did this study at a time when he was requested to do so by the owner of the property. This was a zone change that was initiated by the owner of the property, and this was done to support, I think to support his request for a rezone change. It was not done at the town's, I don't believe it was done at the town's request or with the town's knowledge, but it was an independent survey that was done. So we did not determine when it was done. They determined it.
Well, that's what I wanted to know, whether who determined when he should do the study.
He submitted the application. Mr. Malley, this study was paid for by Mr. Balfour or whatever corporation.
Okay. That's what I wanted to know.
The second point, I could talk to a few people, try to find that out.
Thank you.
Very good. Is there further discussion on item 47 this evening? Councilor Creelman.
Yes, Chairman Latore, I just wanted to make the the point that unfortunately I will be not in the country on November 14th. I'll be out of the country. I made a commitment prior to being elected to the town council, and I feel bad about not being able to partake in the public hearing on this particular issue, which I feel very strongly about. I did, nonetheless, pay very close attention to the discussion at the planning board on September 19th, 1988, and I will send a letter to you with my thoughts that I would appreciate your reading at that public hearing.
Mm-hmm. I'll be glad to do so. Thank you. Are there any other discussions on this? If not, I'd like to move, have the question be voted upon at this time. All those in favor of setting this for public hearing November 14th, 1988? Any opposed? So it passes unanimously 7-0. Moving on to item 48, we have a request from Dyer Pond Associates to agree to accept upon satisfactory completion of proposed public improvements in the proposed Dyer Pond subdivision and take any necessary action. I'd ask the town manager to give us a little introductory remarks on this.
Okay, I drew up a map to show the location of this, and I don't know what happened to the map when I looked at my packet today. It wasn't in it, but the proposed Dyer Pond Road is essentially across from Delano Park, entrance number one, just as you're going down the hill just beyond Fort Williams. This was a proposed subdivision that went before the planning board about 9 months ago now, or even before that, but around 9 months ago. It was given preliminary approval by the planning board. The applicant now is approaching the planning board for final approval. He in the meantime, he's been going through the DEP review process to get his site plan approval at that point. There's been some question. I had a call today over the phone of exactly what's the council being asked to do. It's always been a tradition that any road that's going to become a public road, before the town council, before the planning board gives final approval to the subdivision, the town council is asked to state whether or not you would agree whether or not this ought to be public road and public land. What you're doing is saying that later on, once the road is built, you'll accept the right-of-way and you'll accept the road, provided it's built according to town specifications. So what you're being asked to do tonight is to agree to accept it, provided two things. Actually, generally, there's two things. One is that the subdivision plan receives final planning board approval, and the second one is that all the improvements are built according to the specifications in accordance with that approval. There is a third issue with this one, is that there has been a problem that cropped up of late as to how much of the shoulder of the road would be cleared. Apparently, it was submitted at just a little over 2 feet when the standard is 8 feet on each side. So, you know, I think if you pass this, you know, agree to accept it upon final approval, you should condition it that the shoulder be up to 8 feet in width cleared. The issue, and it's something the planning board, I think, wants to grapple with, is there's an advantage to a lesser width, you know, in that it's more pleasing aesthetically. I think, you know, we all look at some roads where trees have been cleared away and how terrible it looks. And that kind of, there's thought that, you know, perhaps, you know, we don't want to have the clear brush. The other side of it is that we need place to store snow after a snowstorm
and
sight distance.
And a bicycle path.
Yeah, except this is a road going down.
Oh,
this
you're
is the
talking
shoulder.
About that road.
Off
not,
the curb.
Not
yeah.
off Shore
yeah.
Road.
No, this is the curb. So, you know, if you're willing to do this, if you could word it in such a way for the shoulder to be up to 8 feet in width on either side. Other than that, I think it's a very standard acceptance.
Yes, Councilor Cogshill.
I ask permission to withdraw our discussion of voting on this issue due to a possible conflict.
Do we
Mr.
have
a Chairman?
Yes.
I also beg to be excused from voting because of a definite conflict of interest because of the financing of the project.
Do we have a consensus from the other councils to let them abstain from voting because of potential conflict of interest? Generally, we don't take a formal vote, but if we have that feeling, I certainly am in favor of it. So then we will now have basically five councilors discussing this. No one else is dropping out like flies here. Okay, so we have five. Yes, Councilor Amaral.
Yes, a question for the manager. Is the 8-foot shoulder a requirement for other public roads?
That's the standard. And, you know, I sense the planning board is going to go with the 8 feet. It's just that what you have in front of you at this point only shows it as 2 feet.
You mean the planning board has the flexibility to
yes,
require
they,
less?
Yes, they do.
I mean, I feel they have more expertise in that area rather than us tying their hands to the 8 feet. If, you know, if it's built into the ordinance that they have that flexibility anyway, I certainly don't feel I have enough information to make that requirement tonight. But on the other two issues, I know that this is procedure that we've used before. That we agree that we will accept the road if it meets our specifications and meets town standards, even though it hasn't been, even though the subdivision itself is not received final approval. I just would hope that in no way, if we decide to do this, would it indicate that we're supporting or not supporting this particular proposal, subdivision proposal.
Very good. Thank you, Councilor Amaral. Are there any other comments, Councilor Greenwell?
Still dealing with the width of the shoulder issue, I believe I have a fairly good understanding of where this proposed project is, having traveled Shore Road many, many times in this area. And it seems to me if having a 2-foot shoulder would lessen the impact on this wetland, I would certainly like to see less than an 8-foot shoulder. I will say I'm distressed that we have this road going through what I consider and know to be a wetland, period. That's for the planning board to deal with, not us at this point. But I would like to recommend the wording be up to 8 feet. That would be the flexibility for the planning board then to say that it could be as narrow as a 2-foot shoulder. If this is in a wet area. And I would like to see as little impact there as possible.
Very good. Are there other comments?
Yes, I'd like to ask the manager a question. You feel you need the 8 feet as far as snow removal. That is a prime deal. You get away without the 8 feet.
I don't think we need the 8 feet, the full length of the road.
Because I'm getting a little upset at what's going on in some of these roads. Here we are trying to preserve trees and dark conservation and all this and that, and then we have them go in there and cut a big swath. I think Thicket Street is deplorable, the way they've cut that. It used to be such a kind of a pretty area. So they do hang out over the roads in these developments, and I think the people would like it. So I would like to see it, that it would, as Councilor Greenlaw said, up to 8 feet, if they figure they need 8 feet, because you can get by with 2 feet if there isn't any trees and what have you, because you can push it out beyond the trees and so on and so forth. And
there aren't trees there anyway, so you don't have the snow storage problem there as much.
I would like to express my concern with the procedure, as I think I do every time this comes up. I have a tremendous concern, to the point where I almost want to abstain and not vote on this, from why we're asked to vote for these roads when we have absolutely no knowledge of what we're voting on, and when it's simply a procedural move. There's no debate here. As a matter of fact, one councilor even referred to the fact that we may be saying that we want a road built over wetlands, which would later make my vote look rather foolish as far as the history of Cape Elizabeth goes, as far as I'm concerned. So maybe, once again, the manager could enlighten me. What circumstance could ever, would the town council at ever at this point say, no, we simply do not want a road here? Thus, what I'm saying is, what is the purpose of this whole exercise?
Oh, I think it's left over from the old days. I think a lot of it is that you look at the statutes. In order for the town to accept gifts, accept donations, accept property, it has to be approved by the municipal offices. And this is following along with that, so that you actually, you could say no at an earlier date rather than once they actually build the road, and then you say you won't accept it. I think the other factor, and I've mentioned it several other times, and I think it's good time as any, is that we're having increasing problems whenever we don't accept roads as public roads. I've got a request in my office right now for Canterbury Hills Roads to be accepted, Canterbury of the Cape, they're calling it now. You dealt with the Oaks a little while ago. Cranbrook we had a couple of years ago. Anything that's gone in the last 10 years is private road. Once it's been in at least 5 years, and sometimes even fewer amount of years, we've had the citizens living on those roads coming in and requesting. So, I would encourage that the investment be made early on by the developers that these roads be built to the appropriate standards as public roads, because it seems to be what the people on them want in the long run.
I would encourage the ordinance committee to perhaps sometime look at cleaning this up as well, because I think it's a very antiquated procedure that puts me time after time in an uncomfortable position of voting for a road. And again, and every time I have to give the same disclaimer that Councilor Amaro gave, is I absolutely am not saying that I endorse this project or endorse where the road is going, but I'm simply voting this out of a formality. So thank you for letting me vent my frustration on this once again. Councilor Greenlaw.
If we did not vote on this tonight, or if we, let's say if we did not vote on this tonight, would it be appropriate for us to vote on it after it's an approved project? I'm wondering if, I understand they do not have planning board final approval. Are they going for any state approvals that they also do not have in hand?
Yes. It was on the agenda today at the BEP. The board delegated it to the commissioner. So they're just beginning to work on it.
There was a draft motion prepared by the staff.
Well, we didn't see it.
That's
it was just a delegation from us to the commissioner. And I abstained on that, too.
Any project, you have all these little hoops along the way, and this is one of the hoops. Before the planning board gives final approval, the Dyer Pond Associates needs this vote, and they need the permit from the Board of Environmental, or from the Commissioner, apparently now, of the Department of Environmental Protection.
I share Chairman Latore's discomfort, and I will say particularly with this project, because I know it's a wetland. I have a hard time approving a road to go through a wetland, whether it's going to be approved by the planning board or not. And the more I sit here and talk and think about it, the more uncomfortable I'm becoming with it.
That basically, in the 4 years I've had to make decisions here, there's very few times when there isn't two things presented to us where we make a decision on. There's one side of a case, there's another side of a case. This is simply automatic vote and in what could be a later controversial area. And again, it bothers me. Just as a policymaker, I don't believe in this. I hate being forced into a vote. at any time, and that's how exactly how I feel.
But maybe I haven't made it clear. What you're voting, essentially, I think the issue before you is, you know, not whether or not you agree there ought to be a road there or those issues. That's a planning board consideration. What you're essentially being asked to vote for, is this going to be a public road or is this going to be a private road? You know, I have tremendous concerns, and I was deeply involved in this process, highly criticized for it, in that, you know, I think we've got to maintain the ability for long term to see how we can get connector roads to Mitchell Road. There's also a concern, if you look at this, if you look at your plan, there's kind of a little knob that comes out, another little piece of road, and what that does is provide access to the land in the curvy section of Shore Road, I call it the curvy section, across from all the Delano Park entrances. What this does is if that land is ever going to be developed, it could be developed from the back instead of from the front. So therefore, you wouldn't have driveways opening into Shore Road, and you could preserve that wooded appearance by having a considerable setback from Shore Road. You know, unless this is a public road, the planning board in the future won't have a decision to make on that, and they could get a proposal for a development along Shore Road and have all sorts of problems with additional openings onto Shore Road. And, you know, I really think it'd be in the best interest of the town for particularly this one to be a public road, because it preserves the option of having that land on Shore Road developed from the back instead of from Shore Road, with the visual impact and safety impact. And it also preserves a possibility, and only that there could eventually be a connector up into the Stonegate development.
Councilor Green.
The apparent end of this road, not either of the two knobs, but the apparent end, is that a potential hookup to the existing Stonegate subdivision?
Yes. And the covenants in the association agreement state that could eventually be connected, and it is also shown on the plan that a future decision of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board could require that, so that everyone that's buying property on the road is being warned that is within the realm of possibilities.
I would be curious to know if people currently living in Stonegate were warned about this ahead of time.
They were. I've had extensive discussions with them on it. Most of them are in opposition to it. It does come in, though, on the Stonegate plan, which it's also part of. It comes in like only one house from Mitchell Road at what is now the unimproved section. Any traffic that would come up through there would not go through the hole, and in my opinion, would not curve back around and go around out the long way. They'd immediately go into Mitchell and then in either direction.
My concern with that is that there are not, in all those homes, large lawn areas for the children to play in. I foresee them playing in the street, and I'm concerned about it. Let me reiterate the prior question. If we do not vote on this tonight, would it come back to us? Could it come back to us after the planning board had dealt with it as a final approval?
You can do whatever you want with it.
But isn't
that's
this
not an answer.
You know, I think, you know, whatever you would, you know, if you tabled it, if you defeated it, you know, I think, you know, the planning board would decide, you know, with the Dyer Pond Associates at that point, what would be the next course of action. I wouldn't want to speak for either group. I think the ball would then be in their respective court.
The only other point I'd like to make, then, if the decision is actually, if this gets approved by the planning board, do we want this to be a public road or a private road?
Sure.
Isn't that worthy of some discussion or some presentation, or what are the options? I mean, we don't know anything about this development. We don't know a thing about its impact, what the traffic's going to be. How could I even make a reasoned decision as to whether it should be a public or a private road? Every single avenue, I'm getting no information on in terms of if there is actually a decision being made here.
I thought I made that very clear. In the past, these things have been a formality. You know, if you'd like a formal presentation by the planning board, by the developer, I could ask them to attend a future meeting.
Okay.
I guess it's just a basic philosophical question as to whether this council wants to encourage public roads or private roads in subdivisions. And I personally want to encourage strongly the building of public roads, because what happens if you permit the private roads to be built later on, people in that development are going to come back. They're going to want their road plowed by the town. They're going to want the school buses to go there. And they're going to want the road taken care of by the town. And then the road has not been built to the proper specifications. So we really put ourselves in a bind. And that's why I have always been willing to accept this sort of a proposal with stipulations. Because I think it's very important for us as a council to be promoting the building of public roads in subdivisions because of the later cost that it's going to bring, and also all the safety reasons, etc. So I'd like to try a motion. Mm-hmm. See what happens. Mm-hmm. But I'll wait till Bill.
No, you can try your motion, and I'll second it, and I'll make my comment
at
the time.
Okay. I would move that it be ordered that if this project, and I don't know what the name of it is even.
Dyer Pond.
The Dyer Pond project is approved by the planning board. If the Dyer Pond Road is built to town standards and specifications with a shoulder up to 8 feet on each side, the town will accept this road as a public road.
I'll second that motion.
It's been moved and seconded.
One comment, if I may.
Councilor Jordan.
I think Councilor Emerald has taken some of my thinking, and I agree with her 100%. We should be promoting town roads, public roads. We shouldn't be letting them build these private roads, because after the first homeowner moves in, the next one comes in and decides they want it as a public road, and the road isn't built that way. And I think it's a big mistake, and I think we have better control of things if we promote these public roads. And besides, I agree with the manager that this should be a public road, because someday you might want to come out to Mitchell Road, and if that development's going to be expanded, I'd much rather see expanded off of this road than to come in from Shore Road again somewhere down the line. So I think it makes good sense, and I have no problem in second and voting for this, because you're relying upon your planning board, which you do for many other things, and if this is a process, I don't see why we don't move on with it instead of trying to throw a roadblock in it.
It's been moved and seconded with the addition of the 8 foot, up, did you say up to 8 foot?
To 8 foot.
Up to 8 foot shoulder, okay. Further discussion? Yes.
Well, I certainly concur with the opinion about encouraging public roads opposed to private roads. I think that's a very clear issue for all of us, and agree with the town manager. What I have a problem with, I think I share with the chairman of the council, with regard to basically giving the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, I think, the wrong impression that we are rubber stamping a project that may down the line meet with significant problems with the planning board. And I think it gets kind of the locomotive going, and it's tough to slow something like that down, which is historical in several projects that have taken place. So I certainly concur with the recommending and encouraging of public roads. But I am concerned and find it a problem, the chronology of this process. It seems like we really are putting the cart before the horse with regard to what incredible work faces the planning board in the future on this particular project.
Yes.
I think I ought to clarify the planning board process. The planning board goes through a very, very extensive process called preliminary plan approval, before which they hold public hearings. They receive expertise from traffic studies, from wetlands consultants. They have done all of this with this project. The town hired a wetlands consultant, the developer hired a wetlands consultant. The town hired someone to do a traffic survey. The developer had their own traffic survey done. All of that is done. The planning board has already reviewed all of those details. Final approval merely, you know, in the past has always been taking care of the more or less the administrative details. The letter of credit, which guarantees the work will be done, a motion like this, that the financing is in fact in place, those types of things. The planning board has already given us the extensive environmental review, as well as traffic review, with a full team of consultants. That already has taken place.
Well, I'm certainly delighted to hear that, Mike. I'm just disappointed that the only thing I've ever seen on this is this one page with a map and a little intro paragraph. And if all of that is done and we're asked to put some kind of okay or not okay on the project, then it would seem to me only logical that we ought to have that information to review before making an informed decision.
Councilor Amaral?
Yeah, just one point. We're not being asked to put any kind of okay on this project. And that's why my motion, I stated that if, and I would like to emphasize, and only if, this project is approved by the planning board, because I don't feel that in any way, if we vote for the motion that I propose, that we are putting any kind of stamp of approval on the project whatsoever. The only thing that we're dealing with is, if the project is approved through all the proper procedure, and if the road is built to the specifications that the town that the town demands, then we as a town would be willing to accept that as a public road. That's all. It has nothing to do with our approving or disapproving of this project.
But what?
In my mind.
But I think.
And I hope that my motion made that clear. If it doesn't, I'd be happy to.
No, your motion made that perfectly clear, and okay. I just don't like the process.
Just to back that up a little bit further, it's just far too simplistic of a statement. If the planning board, it meets all the planning board approvals, if it meets all the ordinances of the town, are we going to approve it? Of course we're going to approve it. It's a rhetorical question. What else would we do? Would we say, no, we're not going to approve? I mean, it just seems like
such a... Well, we have to accept.
Right, that's what I mean. It just seems so...
We have to vote to accept it.
It seems so simplistic by saying, if it meets all of our requirements, are we going to accept it? Like, what else could we have no other options. We have, so that's...
No, I don't.
Mr. Chairman, you always had the option not to.
That's right.
Approve.
Well, then this would be the time to make that decision, too, I guess. If we do have the option.
I disagree.
So we can, later on, we could not approve it. If it, even though we're saying tonight that we will approve it. Later on, we could say we do not approve it?
No, not
with the motion that's on the floor. Right?
Okay, so then this is the time we're making that decision.
You're making the decision whether or not it's going to be public or private. Whether or not it could possibly be public, that's really the decision you're making. One other, if I may, Mr. Chairman. Up until a year ago, the charter said that the council would approve all plot plans for subdivisions. During the charter review process, that was substantially discussed. It was the unanimous recommendation of the Charter Review Commission that provision be eliminated, that the expertise for reviewing subdivision plans was really best in the hands of the planning board, not the council. Subsequently, that did go to vote of the people, that charter amendment, and it was approved. Well over two-thirds of the citizens stated that plot plans need not be approved by the town council, with the understanding that the planning board would have that responsibility.
Mr. Chairman, as far as seconding the motion and what I feel that I am doing when I vote for this, and I'm in favor of it, that I'm encouraging that development and to be a public road. I'm leaving the rest of it up to the planning board as far as some other details that we've discussed. And I feel that the planning board has gone to the preliminary planning. They have looked into all that, as the manager said just a minute ago. They have looked into it. They've had the surveys and what have you. We're telling them that we encourage them, the developer, that this should be a public road and not a private road.
Just again, for clarification, has the planning board gotten to the point where they're saying this road could be built because it's not wetland? That determination has been made?
They gave it preliminary plan approval. based on, after having reviewed wetland studies done by both the developer's consultant and an independent one hired by the town.
Council Amro?
Yeah, I just want to remind the council that with the charter change that took place as a result of the Charter Review Committee, the council does not have the prerogative any longer to be acting upon subdivision projects. That is totally out of our hands anyway. So that we should not really feel that we have that authority, that any motion that we're going to make would affect approval or disapproval of a project that is no longer part of our responsibility. It is in the hands of the planning board.
Councilor Crowley?
I have one final comment to make, and I won't say anything more on this project. I think I understand the motion. I don't have a problem either voting on this particular issue. I do think in the future, given that pro forma we are using this chronology, that it would be helpful to have some kind of documentation from the planning board in our possession prior to voting yes or no on this kind of issue, based on all of their preliminary work that's taken place. That's all I have to say.
The only other question I'd like to ask Councilor Jordan is would there ever be any possible road that would come before this council where you would say, this should be a private road, not a public road, thus I will not vote in favor of it, based on either where the subdivision was, or is there any scenario by which you would vote that it should be a private rather than public road? Or are you basing your vote based on the individual components of this particular project?
I'm basing it on the project and what the roads could lead to in the future. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't sit here and say that I wouldn't find a road that should be private or not.
Yeah.
And I don't encourage private roads because somebody else is going to live on it a little while and they might not want a private road, so yeah. I would always encourage public roads.
Okay.
But I would just make an offhand comment, which the manager said 2/3 of the people voted in favor of the charter change, but I was in favor of the changes, all but this one, because I felt for a long time that the council should have a say on projects of development within the town. And you've given that all to another body, and I never agreed with that.
Yes, Councilor Greenlee.
I appreciate Councilor Amaro's motion with the stipulations that she added to it. Mike, I agree with Councilor Jordan that, for the most part, a road in a subdivision should be a public road for the good reasons that have been put forward this evening. My concern, I'm realizing, stems from our wetland ordinance, and I would suggest we move forward with haste to correct, in my view, our wetland ordinance.
Okay. Is there any further discussion on the motion that we have on the floor? If not, I'd call for a vote. All those who are in favor of passage, please raise your hand. Any opposed? No. So it passes 5-0. Moving on to item number 49. Item number 49 is to consider approving the warrant for the November 8th, 1988 general election and take any necessary action. And I'd like to call on our town clerk, Deborah Pizzo, to make a small presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As of this morning, we still have not received the warrant from the Secretary of State's office. The council may see fit to authorize the signing of the warrant and to sign the actual warrant at the workshop of the school board that will be held on Monday, October 24th. This would authorize the general election to be held on Tuesday, November 8th. The polls open from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. and the election here in Cape Elizabeth will be held at the high school gymnasium. I did want to point out the reason for the delay in the warrant as the delay in the absentee ballots. We notified the Secretary of State's office that they had approximately 40 candidates resign from office that were supposed to be on the ballot for the November 8 election. As the election laws state now, there are no deadlines for these candidates to resign. Therefore, the Secretary of State's office had to hold up the printing of the ballots and had the political parties have the nomination, their meetings, and so forth for new candidates. Therefore, we have not received our absentee ballots. The council may want to ask its legislative delegation to support legislation to put a deadline on candidates withdrawing. Ultimately, this is disenfranchising our voters. We, as of this morning, have 121 requests for absentee ballots. We have 37 military requests, which go all over the world. And we have a dozen of our own that are going out of the country to France and British West Indies, Malaysia, etc. And unfortunately, I don't believe that we're going to be able to get those back in time to be counted on November 8th. We will send them out as soon as we get them. However, unfortunately for these voters, and they're very disappointed, I don't believe their vote will be cast on the 8th. So I would encourage, as Councilor Greenlaw said before, to take advantage of communicating with your legislature, senator, etc., and try to pass this legislation through on the next legislative session. It's too bad for the voters. It's too bad for my office, in which we get everything ready and send out, and the postage and the time to get all these prepared, and ultimately some of those votes will not be able to be counted because of the time.
Were they Democrats? More Democrats or Republicans?
Both.
Councilor Cogswell.
I wanted to ask Mrs. Pizzo, are the national election ballots already, are they not? Have you received those?
No, we have not.
You won't receive those either until the state...
We will not receive those either, right. I believe they're preparing them on one ballot. So it's holding up, as I said, our warrants, our specimen ballots, and our absentees.
So when do you expect them in? I mean,
according to the Secretary of State's office, it could be as soon as the end of this week. By the time, if I get them in Friday and get all the envelopes prepared and so forth, I've done as much work as I can, you know, up until just getting the ballots. It won't be till the first of the week till these ballots go out, and that leaves about 3 weeks.
So we can do our duty tonight without the ballots here?
If the council wishes, they can authorize to sign the warrant, and at the workshop on Monday the 24th, you can actually sign the warrant. I believe this is what many communities will be, you know, having to do, sign the warrant at a later date.
Could we meet sooner than that once you got them and quick-like and sign the warrant?
The 24th would allow for the posting of the warrant. The state law requires at least 7 days. Provided you don't leave, meet any later than that, the 24th would be fine.
Do we have a motion along those lines?
I so move.
Second. It's been moved and seconded that we are going to authorize the signing of the warrant and then actually sign the warrant at our town council workshop on October 24th. I would also like to ask the town manager to write a letter to both Barbara Gill, our state senator, and Mary Webster, our state representative, indicating the problem that we've had where it's potentially some of our citizens may actually be disenfranchised from voting because of this obvious glaring hole that needs to be filled. And there has to be some kind of a deadline by which a candidate can withdraw such that municipalities like ours are getting ballots in time. And I feel extremely, with all the energy that goes into these elections, sorrowful that even one citizen that wants to vote can't. And it's a very, very important election, so.
I'm going to write to them after the election so that we...
So that you know who's in.
Yes.
Yes,
make
that
sure
would be
won.
Good. After the election.
I'd like to also recommend that all of us sign that letter and try to make it as effective as we can and say that we would be willing to help write any legislation and would be willing to help in seeing that it, doing what we have to do up in Augusta to try to... encourage its acceptance of passage.
Good point. Mm-hmm. I'll go with that.
Councilor Master.
Could I ask Debbie if the Secretary of State gave any reason for so many people withdrawing the last minute?
There was, I talked to Lorraine Fleury, who is the administrative assistant to Peter Danton, Deputy Secretary of State, I believe his title is, and she was just as surprised. She couldn't believe it. It was overwhelming. And I'm really not sure the reasons. It's as much confusion in her office not having those deadlines as it is in our office.
Yes.
Well, I too think it's a tragic embarrassment to the political process in the state of Maine to have this situation transpire as it's happening. If it was not too complicated, I would suggest that in sending out the ballots when they are ready, if we might be able to perhaps add that letter or propose to the person who may not have their vote counted the suggestion that they too write to their state representatives and indicate their extreme displeasure at this situation.
Can we do that legally? Can we just enclose that in the ballot?
I think so.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I think he had brought up a good point that if they receive this ballot and receive it late, it's not our fault. And I think whether we put together a separate letter and a separate mailing,
separate
as
letter.
Each one of them go out.
Yeah, I don't want to break the law on this one.
Yeah.
And as they go out, tack a letter to them explaining what's happened, and they should get it right back in the mail at the earliest possible date. Time.
All the voters that have come in to vote absentee have been informed of this. Some are willing to talk to their legislatures and so forth, but we do make it a point to tell them what has happened, because really it's kind of an embarrassment when they come in and we don't have them yet. We told them in the summer they'd be in approximately 30 days prior to the election. That's in the state law. And so they come in, they've already come in twice, three times, and I'm saying now I'll take your address and I'll send it to you so you don't have to make a trip back in.
Another thought, is there any way that we could provide a special postage on the return envelope to get it back here with absolute quickness rather than the Pony Express sometimes that takes place overseas? Is there any way we can facilitate that?
Not unless we're willing to put Federal Express, which, $12 a ballot or whatever it is.
It's more overseas.
Yeah. And you got to be overseas. It's like we're sending them out airmail overseas. We can do that, but they got to put their local postage over there. Send it back. One thing I should mention: we have leaked this issue to the press. And, I think they're going to do a story on it to check with other towns and help to create an issue out of it.
Okay. Someone actually admitted a leak here. This is incredible. Deep throat.
All in favor of the motion?
Aye. All those in favor of the motion? The motion was to say that we're going to sign the warrant on October 24th.
The motion was so moved.
It was a move. All those in favor? Any opposed? It passes unanimously. Item 50 is our last regularly scheduled item on the agenda, and it is to consider a letter from the chairman of the Thomas Jordan Trust Committee regarding the proposed conservation easement with the Rachel Carson Wildlife Refuge and take any necessary action. I would like to read excerpts, brief excerpts from this letter so that the people in our audience here and people at home can come up to speed on what we're basically talking about with regarding this to this Thomas Jordan Trust Study Committee and the two requests they're making of the Town Council this evening. The first request is that, and I'll start quoting from the letter from here, that the Town Council delay the final execution of the conservation easement documentation with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service of the United States Department of the Interior. The committee's been advised that all or a large portion of the land which will be subject of this conservation easement is within the boundaries of the property given by Thomas Jordan to the town. And the committee needs additional time to advise the council concerning the fiduciary duties and obligations which the town may have in connection with the property, inasmuch as the town attorney has advised the committee that a trust relationship exists in this case. Thus, we would request that the execution of this conservation easement documentation be delayed until we have had a chance to make a report, at least in preliminary form, to the council. The second request that they make of us is we would like to have an extension on the date by which they had a report to us. Originally it was December 1st, and now they've asked us to extend that date to April 1st, 1989. This is some preliminary background to item 50, and I would now like to have it open up to discussion by our council if there's no one present that wishes to comment on this. Seeing none, some councils would like to begin the discussion. I would like to ask the manager initially then, what, I mean, being that we have taken great pains, and it's been quite a long period of time, to hammer out this agreement, which is a fairly complicated agreement, we've been giving it the green light all the way to the point where it's created tremendous enthusiasm within the citizenry. Certainly, it's gotten attention it deserves, both in the Press Herald and in the Cape Courier, et cetera. Would this have any negative ramifications from a federal point of view in terms of balking at this stage, at this juncture?
I think it's safe to assume that they will not be pleased. At the same time, we have had an additional problem crop up in that they're asking us for a warranty deed when there's no way, with the conservation easement, when there's no way that we can warrant to them that we, in fact, do, you know 100% sure that we own all the property. And, you know, our attorney had indicated them we would only be willing to give a quitclaim deed. So I think that there's even, you know, this is an important issue, but there's also an additional very substantive issue that is holding up the process at this point.
But is that issue a completely separate issue that has to be dealt with, and pretty much it's kind of independent issue from this, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Well, I just wanted to get that clarified with that was what, when the town manager wrote in his notes to us regarding there was another problem or another breakdown, so to speak, in the quickness of the signing. That is another area to be discussed, but it isn't really necessarily totally pertinent to the voting here tonight on these two requests. Someone have their hand?
I let the ladies always go first.
No, I was, as a member of the Thomas Jordan Trust Study Committee, we have spent a lot of time determining, first of all, whether or not there really was a trust, and according to the attorney, there is. But that the town in the past perhaps has not acted totally as a trustee in considering the use of this land. And since this is a large amount of the land that we believe is in the trust, that we would not be acting properly by just doing it automatically, that we need more study. That as a town and town council, if we actually own the land ourselves, we could act much more freely. But as trustees, it's much more complicated.
Yes, Councilor Creelman.
I have no problem with the with part two, with extending the deadline to April 1st, 1989. What I would hope, or what I would perhaps recommend, is that there might be a two-part story here, that we might clear up the fiduciary duties in a prior preliminary report, hopefully as soon as possible, to free up the decision we made with regard to the Rachel Carson, and hopefully that could be before the April 1st final reporting, if that's possible.
I guess what I'm still not clear on, maybe, if you don't mind if I just ask this one question to help clear it up. When we went through all the months and months, almost a year of deliberations, did we not know that we didn't own the land outright? Or did we not know we were acting as trustees? Mm-hmm. We did know.
Bill Jordan knew that you didn't own it all.
Okay, but either way, I'm just wondering if we would have made a different decision if it was totally focused on us being trustees versus us owning land. I personally wouldn't have voted any differently. Mm-hmm. But go ahead, Councilor Amor.
Same here, because we realized that whatever money settlement, that financial settlement we made with the Rachel Carson people would be put into a fund for the Corps. Mm-hmm. So that's what I thought we were doing, was acting as trustees for the Corps, as was set up in this trust fund. So. I don't really understand why, unless they feel that we did not negotiate a high enough fee, that we were not being tough enough as trustees or whatever. So I certainly would not have voted any differently either.
Right. Councilor Mastin?
I don't remember the name of the real estate
No, but he was a federal employee.
Didn't he assure us that in the face of one of the councilors suggesting that those deeds weren't clear and they were encumbered, that that they were okay? He was not concerned about that.
No.
Yeah, he did say that.
He did say that, but we're in a whole different area now of trust and trust law. You know, I think he was more looking at land ownership rather than what the responsibilities of the town might be as a trust. This committee has, I've attended one and a half of their meetings. They've met twice. The council did a tremendous job appointing this committee. They're extremely talented people. They take their responsibility very, very seriously. And they're raising some extremely difficult issues, ones that, you know, we're not going to find pleasant facing. They go well beyond what's come here, and I think you'll see it in the minutes of their meeting, including whether or not, for example, the refuse disposal area ought to be on this property. And, you know, the issues are really significant. And, you know, I'd say they feel fairly strongly that, you know, you really ought to hold up on doing anything until everyone fully understands what it means to be a trustee for an estate like this. And I think that's what Mr. Wakeland's letter as chairman of the committee implies.
I'll move that we don't, that we not authorize the manager to sign that deed to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife, Rachel Carson people. And I would like to make one comment. And this is for, the committee is looking into it. I don't know how far down the road they've gone, but there is an Adams family that has claimed for years that once a town does away with a trusteeship, as this land, it reverts back to that family, which tied to the Thomas Jordan, if you follow the family tree back. And he tried 5 or 6 years ago, and maybe it was long ago than that, he has since passed away now, so I guess he won't bother us anymore, but he tried to get money out of the town. He was going to pursue it when we put the first treatment plant on that land. And then when he heard the next one was coming along, and he said it wasn't legal to do it, and he was trying, he didn't have $20, so he was trying to get some bucks to get somebody to help him pursue that. And he contacted me 2 or 3 times, and I told him that it would be quite a long process, but it was up to him. I wasn't going to pursue it for him. And I wish he was alive now, because he would smile.
I'll second Councilor Jordan's motion.
Okay, it is moved and seconded to delay the final execution of the conservation easement with the Fish and Wildlife Service pending further study by the committee. So we will now have discussion on that. I personally am not inclined to vote in favor of the motion because of all the amount of work that went into the original thought, and also my particular mindset upon voting it. I was looking at it as protectively as I possibly could for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth as a trustee, and in every possible way. We did negotiating, we had some give and take, and I can't really clearly in my mind or conscience say that I would have approached it any differently than I did. And I also feel that we had the town manager and the town attorney telling us we were within our legal rights to go through this process and take the town and the citizens through this process, which we did, to cause, you know, a certain level of anticipation and interest and excitement that's been generated over our approach to managing that land with professional managers. And I simply am not convinced enough yet to have to rescind that vote. That's my, yes, Councilor Cogshaw.
It is extremely complicated, and we have people who are well-versed in the law on this committee, and I am not one of them. So I am learning as well as you. But just in your statement alone, from what was said to us in the committee, was the fact that you were trying to do what was best for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth by granting this conservation easement on the marsh. The fact is that you, as a trustee, are supposed to be doing the best you can for the poor of the town and not necessarily for the town in general. And that is been part of the problem over the years of the town council, is not being able to separate the two. Mm-hmm. And that's what we must do, and it's best that we wait before things become even more complicated by committing more of this land, perhaps not for the right purposes or in the best way.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I feel sorry that you was trying to lay this on the doorstep of the manager and our town attorney of our taking our vote. I don't believe we empowered the town attorney or give him the bucks to research this, and they relied too much upon the feds that come in here and sold this program, and they done the research on fire as the ownership. And I think the town attorney and the manager and myself, which I didn't agree with them, took it for granted that they were right. And that we're finding out that we shouldn't always agree with the feds and not do our own research.
Okay, I just need to clarify, I guess, just for my own statement so that they're clear. If the question is whether or not I was trying to get the best for the citizens or the poor farm fund, I was very aware that all the monies was going into the poor farm fund, so thus I was acting in that capacity as well. And I didn't make any differentiation in my own mind.
No, but the question is whether or not that was the best way to get money for the poor fund.
I just think it's unfortunate this is, you know, coming up at this juncture. I really do. I mean, in terms of the whole administrative process.
It should have been done years ago. We should really have researched this topic, but it was very expensive in researching the deeds and the lineage, and they've spent a lot of time, and there's still questions that they're trying to answer. So it's going to be a very expensive process, but it'll be much more expensive if we continue the way we have in the past and not just put this on hold. We're not saying we can't do it. Let's make sure that we are, if we do it, that we do it correctly.
This is really a tough one because I think we're all so ecstatic. A couple of months ago when we had the unanimous 7-0 vote to go with this easement, granting this easement to the Rachel Cosin people and having that Refuge Forever managed and providing money for the poor of Cape Elizabeth. It seemed like we had come up with an ideal resolution to all of the issues that we had addressed over a long, long period of time. However, at the same time, we've known that we should have been addressing this whole Thomas Jordan Trust for years, and we didn't do anything about it. We finally did appoint what I consider a blue ribbon committee, a really top-notch committee, and now they're telling us to slow down a little bit. So I personally have a real problem with the motion because I feel torn. I'd like to see that land. I think that our original vote was very well thought out. It was unanimous, and to have to back off from that is tough. But maybe, I mean, we've got some great people here. I respect their opinion. I think that I'm leaning toward voting for Councilor Jordan's motion.
Councilor Mastin.
We are not. They are also asking us in this letter to extend their deadline for producing their report from December 1 to April 1. We are not talking forever here.
No.
We're just asking the manager to postpone the formal execution of the deed or whatever it is he has to sign. Is it a deed?
Easement.
Conservation easement deed form.
Okay. I agree. I thought we did a great thing by deciding to grant an easement to Rachel Carson, but things change. Nobody's perfect, and new information crops up. So I don't feel badly about putting off the final execution. I'm assuming that maybe we'll be able to work this out.
Mm-hmm. Certainly doesn't kill the project by any means.
No, that's the concern. It might, though.
But we want to do the right thing, and I agree with our manager that a trust relationship is, you know, you have legal obligations, and we may not have been carrying them out all these years that we've had the dump up there. And that is more serious than granting a conservation easement.
Yes, Councilor Cogshaw.
At the time that we all unanimously voted, we also were taking the word of the government real estate expert that they were happy that we were just granting the easement, and now they're changing their whole approach, where instead of the quick claim deed, they want a warranty deed, and we did not vote for that. We were not, because we did not feel we had enough information that we actually own the land to be able to give them anything like a warranty deed, and so we voted with those kinds of stipulations. So they're changing it too. And we know we're not positive about the land yet. And the land has been sitting there for a number of years in its present condition, and it would still continue to be that way until we get the report of the committee. It doesn't mean that it might not be the best solution for the land, but let's...
Mm-hmm. I guess the last point that I just don't understand is, in making these types of very important votes, what, and I would address this to the town manager, what level, what threshold did we cross where you felt we were comfortable and on solid footing? I mean, there's a certain amount of trust element, obviously it has to go on between the administrators and the council. What threshold did we cross that you felt we were on a legal footing to be able to make such a vote? I mean, that it was brought to us as an agenda item and we were able to vote. You certainly must have reviewed it with the town attorney and felt comfortable in your mind that we were on legal ground. Is that, we didn't rely on the feds, we relied on our own people.
The town had already taken the position, and particularly much work was done when the Portland Water District lease was signed by the town for the treatment plant, that, you know, as long as you were getting a reasonable return back, you know, you were leasing it out, you weren't selling it, you were getting money, you were trying to do something for the poor, that would be sufficient. We relied on that. There was extensive work done by both the Portland Water District and by Tom Leahy on that. Subsequently, this committee was appointed. I believe there's four people with law degrees serving on it. They feel quite strongly that there is the trust agreement. For example, you know, on this issue alone, you know, if you are to get the highest best use out of the land in your trustee responsibility for the poor, you know, perhaps the area that was marsh you should have given full rights without all the conservation restrictions, so you maximize the dollars that you got back, and that you as a trustee, not as a council, you as a trustee should have been looking for the maximum dollar rather than for looking for all those other restrictions to win it, which brought down the value. That's I'm not saying I
yeah,
agree with
no,
that,
I know.
But that is what the committee is effectively saying at this point. You know, I think I've said this before, but I always remember it. Abraham Lincoln said that I'll adopt new views when they appear to be true views. You know, I learning never stops, and you know, I hope that I'm always willing to change my mind and to move forward when new information comes out.
Thank you for that. During presidential election fervor, I think it's appropriate to quote Abraham Lincoln. Yes.
Maybe there are too many lawyers on that committee.
Well, we have a motion. Which does the motion include, by the way, the second request to?
No, I was going to move that in a minute.
Okay, so why don't we vote
I'll
on
the
first?
Question.
Why don't we vote on the first
okay.
question, which is the first request that they have made of us. All those in favor of the first request, please signify by raising your hand, which would mean a delay, the council delaying the execution of this deed. Please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right.
Aye.
All those opposed. So it's 6-1. Okay. The second part is...
Mr. Chairman, I move that we extend the deadline for the report of the Thomas Jordan Trust Study Committee to be presented to the council from December 1 to April 1, 1989.
I'll second it.
Been moved and seconded. Any further discussion on the extension? Yes, Councilor.
Is there any interest on the part of council members with a proviso to try to clear up the fiduciary duty prior to April 1st?
If possible.
Can that
well,
be?
I was going to say with the hopes that they could wrap it up earlier, but I don't know. You have to. I don't know. You can amend it if you want.
Well, my track record on these things. I'm not going to propose. I wanted to get a general sense of the members.
Oh, get back
council.
In the batter's box, Wayne. Go ahead. You're bound to hit one out of here.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
Don't you feel once a committee solves that problem, it's pretty much completed its duty, so we would have the answer
no.
to
no.
that?
No.
Minor.
Oh, yes.
Minor.
Several other duties.
Well, I don't want to get a study half through and make a decision and then find out they end up with something else to complete the study when they complete the study. So I think we better wait till they're completed and then make our decision.
That's with the motion.
Thank you.
Okay. Any further discussion on this?
I don't want to change.
Then we will vote on the motion, which has been seconded. All those in favor? Any opposed? None. It passes unanimously. That concludes the regularly scheduled agenda items, and we now have citizens' discussions of items not on the agenda. For those of you in the audience and watching at home, we have this segment at the beginning of a meeting, and for those of you who wish to, our latecomers, at the end of the meeting. So are there any citizens that wish to step forward?
Don't all come forward.
Please step forward. No, last chance.
Mr. Chairman.
But we also have our little miscellaneous segment here before all of you tune out to the baseball game.
Wait,
yes.
Just a minute. Mr. Chairman. I would like to bring an item up out of order. Number item 51. What it is the ordinance for the farm fish markets that just got presented to the manager tonight before the meeting. And I think we ought to act on it and set it to a public hearing.
Ordinance committee?
To the ordinance committee, and then set it to a public hearing. So I'll send you all a copy around. Take one and pass on.
While we're getting the...
I think it's unfortunate that it come in at such a late time, but I think it's important enough so it ought to be referred to the ordinance committee so it can continue down the road.
You making a motion?
So I will make that in the form of a motion.
I will second it.
Did I pass enough along, or do I have...
I didn't get one, but...
Oh.
Yeah.
While we're all digesting this, which is being proposed as item number 51, and we are getting the packets delivered to us right now, I'd like to, the manager, just to clarify again some procedural points in terms of Robert rules of order, just to refresh our memories on what would we need to do to legally take up an item out of order, as opposed to the curfew that comes that if nothing is in your office by Wednesday at noon, it cannot appear on the agenda. Can you clarify that for me?
You know, I think to take up an item not on the agenda, you have to suspend the rules in order to take up an item not on the agenda. That's the standard motion. I assume that's the motion Councilor Jordan made.
That is correct. The motion.
And
item
that
51.
Takes
five
votes, I believe. I'm not positive. To suspend the rules. Mm.
So you are then moving to suspend the rules and take up an item 51.
That's right.
No. We're having discussion as to whether or not to suspend the rules to take up item 51.
I know this issue is a pressing issue in town, and there's a lot of concern about it, and it's moved very slowly. However, procedurally, we just received this. And to set something to public hearing that we haven't even looked at.
Not the ordinance committee.
I share your discomfort in setting it for public hearing, but I have no problem with setting it to ordinance.
Don't you trust us, Jane?
Yeah, I trust you. It's just procedural. It's just that it's not really a great idea to do something at the last minute like this, but we will have several opportunities, I'm sure, to look at it before any action is recommended or any action at all is taken.
Okay. I guess I trust Billy, too, because we're sending whatever it is he just said down here. Skimming it over, I don't see anything that highly controversial.
You have
Frank.
A question?
Yes.
At one point, this is dated July 29th, in reference to a planning board meeting at July 25th, and I thought somewhere I had seen scheduled a planning board public hearing on this in September.
That's right.
Was that held?
Mm. That is correct.
Then why can't we have a copy of what happened there?
This
instead
is
of, is this the way it went?
This is what the chairman of the planning board gave me this evening. I had spoken with her early today after trying to get a hold of the planner to get a copy of it, and I know the council likes to have things forwarded from the boards, and for some reason they never forwarded it, and I started to get questions when the agenda went out, how come it wasn't on the agenda, and my response was, well, I never got it, and it was an oversight on the part of either the planning board or the planner or whatever, that it just never came to me for presentation to the council.
Well, I would also like to see a copy of the final results of their public hearing.
Mrs. Rand said this is it.
This is it, even though it's not dated that way?
Yeah, with the scribbled notes on it.
Is there any communication we might like to send back the other way asking for?
Well, we had talked about having deadlines for, or at least set time periods for ordinance changes when they've been delegated to the planning board in the process. Mm-hmm. And I think this is a good example of reinforcing deadlines if an item comes up that we have a final time when we'd like it referred back to the council.
Okay, that's a good point. If there's no further discussion, I would like to now vote on suspending the rules and taking up item number 51. All those in favor? Any opposed? 6-1. So we will now take up item 51, which is the farm and fish market recommendation from the planning board in terms of proposed changes to our ordinance.
So I believe it'd be in proper order if I make a motion that we refer this farm and fish market ordinance amendments to the ordinance committee for review.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to send these to the ordinance committee for review. All those in favor? Any opposed?
Is there discussion on this?
Yes, there is. Sorry, but I didn't foresee any. And once again, my telepathy is off, so go right ahead.
I would like to just discuss it for a moment because I really have a major problem with these kind of procedural issues, you know, floating down with a moment's notice. I spend considerable time going over the materials that I receive before these meetings. And although I'm certainly not anti-sympathetic or sympathetic at all about this particular issue, I just think it's a very dangerous precedent to set, to suspend the rules with a complicated issue like this. It's not a paragraph. It's a four-page document that I certainly am not going to begin to digest at this point of the process. And I just feel that it's not the right way to do things here. I may be in a minority, but that's my contribution to the discussion.
And I would say that I agree 100% wholeheartedly with you and would have voted against it, except for the fact that this originated with us. We then, and as a matter of fact, grappled with it at great length when I was chairman of the ordinance committee. So I have a little bit more historical background on it. And sometimes I think citizens get extremely frustrated with how slow the government moves, you know, and this is an example. We certainly have been discussing this for a long time, should have had it back earlier, but if we can suspend the rules to help move this along a little quicker for this particular one, given its historical background from the council, I'm going to be voting in favor of this one. Yes, Councilor.
I agree with Wayne. I think this is a very bad policy to waive the rules for an item like this, but I also know the historical background, which is only the only reason why I voted to waive the rules, especially something as complicated as this.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I
don't you feel sorry now you did this?
No, I don't.
Okay.
I don't feel
about 5 minutes.
Excuse me. I don't feel the least bit sorry that we're doing it because I think it's something we should move forward. Other committees have dragged their feet on this and dragged them, and here we have a plan coming. You talk about wanting open space, you want to keep the farm, you want to keep the fishermen, and then people drag their feet and not pushing this along at a reasonable length of time. Now, they had their meeting, they had the hearing, and to me, they had time enough to get that to this council before tonight at 7:30, because I think I walked in, and the manager told me he just received it because I said hello to Alice on the way in, and Debbie went up and made us copies. And I think this is ridiculous. And it's a damn poor process. And it's something that we ought to be able to do to get it corrected. So if they don't want it, why don't they say so and say they're going to drag their feet so we can push them instead of dragging their feet otherwise? Well, I'm very disappointed.
Is there a consensus then to send any communication back the other way? With all the frustrations being vented, why don't we feel that we would like to write a letter to the planning board asking why they had a public hearing in the end of, you know, middle of September or whatever it was, and on such an important issue to the community, and we didn't get it in time for the deadline? They certainly must know what the rules are that has to be in by Wednesday at noon.
I think it was simply an oversight.
I think we should send them a letter. Does anyone else agree. I don't see why it hurts us to go on record stating this.
I think a reminder would be in order of what the deadline is.
Okay.
And we were disappointed that it was not met.
I think a lecture is better.
What was the deadline?
Wednesday at noon.
I agree with the letter.
Mm-hmm. I agree with the letter. And I also would ask the town manager to forward to the ordinance committee any minutes reflecting conversations or statements for the public hearing that was held by the planning board, if they are in existence.
There were minutes taken. They have not been forwarded in my office yet.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, after we vote on this, I want to make another comment on similar to what Phyllis had just said.
Okay. Is there any further discussion on sending it to the ordinance committee? If not, I would like to ask for a vote. All those in favor of sending item 51 to the ordinance committee? All those opposed?
I'm abstaining from the issue.
Okay. 6-0-1.
You have to vote on something you haven't read.
Did you want to make another comment, Councilor Jordan, before we get to miscellaneous?
We always talk about that we'd like to know what's going on and different things, and we form these committees, and they do certain things, and so on and so forth. Here's a report from the Field Advisory Commission dated March 29th, 1988, and I just received it in my packet, and I believe the rest of you received it. Now, seems so we could get the minutes of a meeting a little sooner than that. Maybe they didn't meet all summer, and they met this fall and decided to accept the minutes and then send us a copy of them. That's probably the process. So how are you going to keep up to date on what's going on when you get them that late? Now, they just met, I take it. So when they meet again in 3 or 4 months, we get another set of what's going on. I think there's maybe some way, if somebody takes minutes at that meeting, they could pass them on to somebody within the town office, and we could get a copy of what was going on.
With a note that they're not approved minutes.
Right.
What?
I think with a note that they have not been approved minutes of a given committee.
Can you do that?
But I agree, I think
some of
the time lapse is unfortunate.
Maybe what I'll do is put an item on the agenda. There's a section, boards and commissions, Section 4-1-5 of the ordinance, which provides that boards, commissions, or committees shall keep accurate minutes, which shall give public notice. And I think that there's a real issue here, not only the council knowing, but the public's right to know. You know, we may be in violation of the freedom of access law by not having timely minutes. So perhaps the ordinance committee ought to consider an amendment to this ordinance, setting a timetable that minutes shall be in the clerk's office no later than so many days, working days, after a public meeting, in order for, you know, the council's reason stated, as well as to ensure that we're in conformance with the freedom of access law.
You really need an ordinance for that. I mean, couldn't that be an administrative letter?
We have ordinances for every little.
I know. But with lay people working on boards and the turnover, there's not a continuity.
Mm. And chairman and policy or something like that, a written policy that we could circulate?
That's what I'd like to see, that instead of an ordinance. Just a policy that we send to the chairman when they take over, asking, here's some policies we'd like you to follow. That would be one of them. Okay.
Michael, you're looking dubious.
No, no problem.
Yes, you are. A few miscellaneous items before we, for housekeeping things, before we close down here. A reminder, the workshop of the school with the school committee is going to be October 24th, and I would like Michael to send out an agenda, of which he and I talked briefly about what an agenda for that would be, and you'll be sending one out before our meeting.
Yeah, could we mention those?
Right now the agenda items are, we'd like an update on what building plans are happening in terms of roofs and other major repairs that at one point had been talked about, even possibly a bond issue being needed to redo roofs, et cetera. So updating on the building plans, the drug and alcohol in the schools, which I think Councilor Creelman hopefully will be an integral part of that discussion as well, is certainly going to have a high place on the agenda. And also the issue that came up during budget time, which was the synchronization somewhat of the salaries between the school department and the town, and how they have been out of sync, causing great problems regarding the town when we are not following the same levels in terms of pay. They've been kind of independently going off, and maybe we need some synchronization, and it was decided at the budget meeting not to discuss it in the heat of the budget, but rather at a workshop later. So those are the three, and also possibly further utilization of the comptroller would be another item worthy of discussion. If any of you have any other items, which I'd really ask you to bring forward to the manager within the next few days that you'd like to see on the agenda to discuss with the school committee. Because the reason I point that out is we've discussed at length how many, at a lot of meetings that we want to meet with the school board, and now that we've got their attention, let's make sure that we get everything out that we want to and not leave any issues lingering. So I really would ask the next couple of days you give it some thought and call Michael if there's some additional agenda items that you'd like to see and lead the discussion on that at what I think could be a very important workshop, and hopefully it'll be the beginning of some regular workshops with them. I also would like to schedule another workshop for November, because some counselors and other people have asked me to discuss certain of our goals, which we have certain goals such as the bikeway, we have certain goals such as looking at our whole transfer station setup, what hours do we want to have it, do we want to talk about pickup. There's a lot of other issues that are lingering out there that can only be talked about in a workshop format. So is there any November date that we could find mutually possible?
Thanksgiving Day.
Sure. How's Wednesday, November 16th?
I'll be away that week.
We could allow that week. Could we avoid that week?
Mm-hmm.
We'll probably get
How's Tuesday, the 22nd of November? Is that?
Oh, that's Thanksgiving week. No.
That'd be fun.
Hmm?
That's Thanksgiving week. Okay.
That'd be a good day. You don't put your turkey on Tuesday,
or
Wednesday,
or
Thursday.
I'll still
thaw
it on Tuesday.
22nd.
22nd's all right?
No.
No?
You can go ahead and have it. I just won't be here.
We have it earlier?
What about the 8th?
That's election night.
No. Oh.
It's a good night.
I have another
stable. Well, did we say the 10th was out?
The 11th is a holiday. Long weekend.
Another long weekend.
But it's the 11th is Veterans Day.
I definitely would like to have it before the National League of Cities, which is December 5th, Monday.
November 9th. Wednesday the 9th.
What was wrong with the 10th?
Is the 10th acceptable? Okay.
It's the one-act play competition.
I have something, but it's in the afternoon. I think I'd be here.
Your 7:30 workshop, Frank?
7:30, yes.
At that workshop, will also Glenn Kirstein will be invited, who is our auditor, to present to you an overview of the management letter and the audit, which you'll be getting a copy of in the next few weeks.
Mm-hmm. And again, I would like any counselors that have certain issues that they would like to have at that workshop. And I'm not necessarily saying issues that you want to push, but issues that are of concern in terms of our council goals. We're moving ahead on some of our goals, and then looking over our list on others we're not. And we're going to, the best way to take them up is as we have in the past, just at workshops, and we see where we're going with them. So contact me or the town manager if there's something that you'd like. I plan on having some information about regional waste, because I'd like to discuss that letter that came, which is a very important letter, increasing the indebtedness from $76 million to $85 million. That's not a light decision. And Glenn Kirstein will be there, bikeway, and talking about the dump or issues right away. So, yes.
On the regional waste item, I think we should invite Lester Jordan, who is our representative on the regional waste board, to give us an update and a full explanation of what's happening there, either at a workshop or at our next council meeting or whenever. But I think it's really important that we be communicating with Lester on that whole issue.
There's one change on this list.
Yeah.
The Affordable Housing Committee is listed for October 20th, and that's been changed to the 27th. Are we doing one the 20th also?
27?
Didn't we change it to the 27th?
I just got a note. I thought it was the 24th.
That's the field trip. The 27th. The public forum is the 27th.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, on this list, the ones that the councilors should circle, all the councilors, would be the October 24th, your regular council meeting November 14th, the COG forum that Jane mentioned earlier on the 15th, the Fort Williams public forum you may want to attend that on the 17th, and there is the Affordable Housing Forum as well on October 27th, and the now the workshop on November 10th.
Did you ask that we start the workshop with the school board at 7?
I just whispered it to you.
Yes. That sounded like a good idea. 7 instead of 6? Instead of 7:30?
Wait a minute.
With Lester during the first half hour.
With Lester during the first half hour.
This is on the 24th. Hang
and then meet with the school board at 7:30.
My other question with Lester, though, is if, given that the Regional Waste Board has gone into executive session regularly lately, he may need for us to go into executive session in order to brief us.
Good point.
Because every meeting has been in an executive session. So if we want to be briefed, we're going to have to go into executive session. Otherwise, all he'll be able to tell us is basically what's been in the paper.
I think he better get an opinion from Nick Nadzo, their attorney, because everything that was discussed in executive session is just about public now, because they have voted now on those actions that they discussed in executive session.
Okay. Well, would you just take that up with former Councilor Jordan?
I'll have Lester.
To make sure that he's comfortable with what we're asking, because he did say that he did not want to be put in an awkward position. He did mention that to him, so.
I'll give him a call.
Okay. So we're at 7 o'clock then on October 24th instead of 7:30, but you'll be sending out an agenda.
Come on now.
Should be 6 o'clock and have dinner, but I won't push there.
Well, you won't see me
now.
At 6 o'clock.
So October 27th is the Affordable Housing Public Forum.
Been changed?
That's been changed.
Wow. Any other?
We hope you all come.
Any other little miscellaneous items? If not, I'd entertain
a motion. I have one.
Oh, Councilor Jordan.
I have one. I like your comment, Nancy, as far as affordable housing going over like a lead balloon. You've got good press on that.
Yes. Anything negative gets
very
wonderful
quotable
press.
That's right. I read the minutes of the community services, and I'd like to have the manager explain one thing to me. According to town charter, any year in surplus from the community service goes back in the town general fund. The town council can vote to return the surplus to the school department, and the board can in turn put the money back into the community services and carry forward balance. The surplus for 88 is $40,165, $10,000 of which is already consumed in the 89 budget. Then it goes on and say the Sue and Dee LaBelle, school department business manager, are preparing a report to the board detailing ways to utilize these monies. Now, did they come back to you and you sent them back to them, or how does that work now?
We've had extensive discussions between the superintendent of schools, myself, Dee LaBelle, Sue Weatherby. We also, Dee LaBelle and I met with the auditor yesterday on it. The position that is evolving at this point is that community services is now a department of the school department. School department funds under state law, surplus stays within the school department. I think the way it's going to come out is that the funds are going to lapse into the school department surplus account. And then it's up to the elected body, the school board, whether or not they reallocate that back to community services. As far as the $10,000 that's already been spent, that was merely a revenue listed in the budget, much as we do with our own surplus. We have $170,000 use of surplus to help fund the next year's budget, and that's what the $10,000 is going to
have. Okay, my next question then. So we're going to have a charter change? It says here that according to the town charter.
No, the town charter reads that any surplus within a department lapses into the general fund unless it's for a capital project. However, that doesn't apply to the school department because of the state statute that overrides the charter.
So because they was consumed with the school department, so this part of the town charter is no longer in effect?
It is not for that aspect. I picked up the fact that I read it in some previous minutes or somewhere that community services was deciding what to spend the money on just at the say-so of the superintendent or the the business manager, and I met with them and pointed out that, you know, the elected body has to make those decisions. We had a nice discussion on it.
Do you think we should have a discussion at the time that we meet them? But it's a lost cause now because they're consumed up in the school department, community services.
The school boards, to my knowledge, have still not discussed the issue, and maybe that's something, if you want to discuss on the 24th, we could add that to the agenda.
We can get by the drug issue. I'll bring this up.
We'll add it to the agenda.
Any
Make
further?
A motion, we adjourn.
Second.
Moved, seconded. All those in favor of adjourning?
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Passes unanimously. Thank you, those in the audience and those in the
room.
I got
what you want to bring up.
It'll call
for adjourn.
Well, yeah,
I wanted to get up.
I wrote to the state just said they don't have any money in the budget.
Hey, let's reconvene because Nancy wants to do a dance.
Yeah, we don't have any money now.
Okay.
I think that's
so moved.